words this morning were written by my colleague Kathleen McTeague. We come together this morning to remind one another to rest for a moment on the forming edge of our lives, to resist the headlong tumble into the next moment, until we claim for ourselves awareness and gratitude, taking the time to look into one another's faces and see there a communion, the reflection of our own eyes. This house of laughter and silence, memory and hope is hallowed by our presence together. This morning I propose to delve into a topic where proverbially the angels themselves fear to tread, or at least Unitarian Universalists, the topic of fear, and in particular of faith without fear. I would propose to you that fear is one of the fundamental building blocks of the human experience and has been since the beginning of our species. And it is a building block upon which we construct a sense of self to build behaviors that act as walls to ward off various fear. And as a consequence, when we gather together, we build civilizations to address those many fears, be they plague or war, invasion. There are many, many fears that have plagued us, both in terms of community as well as individually. I recently Googled phobia, which of course is the Greek word for fear. And the word phobia is attached as a suffix to many other Greek roots to describe personal fears. At the top of the most common phobias is arachnophobia, the fear of spiders. There was a footnote saying that women are much more likely to experience arachnophobia than men. Among the other phobias that are in the top 15 are fear of failure, fear of closed spaces, claustrophobia, and also fear of public speaking. In terms of building blocks, religion also seeks to address our many fears. Imagine with me, if you will, our ancient ancestors who had to scrounge for food, who relied on optimum weather to grow things. And then there was the great unknown amongst them, something that stole silently into their villages and killed children, took away the elderly. Droughts came. They looked above in the heavens, and they saw among the stars strange travelers, be they planets or perhaps the occasional comet. And all was a portent of doom, doom being the ancient English word for judgment. And so as things collapsed around them, either personally in their families, their fortunes, or of their towns or cities, they sought to make sense out of this world. I'm told that one of the defining characteristics of human beings is that we are the ones who discern patterns. Sometimes, even when patterns are not there, our imaginations leap forward and we seek to connect the dots. Like so many stars in a constellation, we crave meaning, we crave a justification, and above all, we crave protection from all the many ills that befall us. Bertrand Russell said this about religion and its relationship with fear. Religion, he says, is based primarily upon fear. It is partly the terror of the unknown and partly as the wish to feel that you have a kind of elder brother who will stand by you in all of your troubles and disputes. Fear of the mysterious, fear of defeat, fear of death. Fear is the parent of cruelty and therefore it is no wonder if cruelty and religion have often gone hand in hand. It is because fear is at the basis of these two things. In this world, we can now begin a little to understand things, and perhaps a little to master them by help of science, which has forced its way step by step against the opposition of all the old precepts. Science can help us to get over this craven fear in which humankind has lived for so many generations. Science can teach us, and I think our own hearts can teach us, no longer to look around for imaginary supports, no longer to invent allies in the sky, but rather to look for our own efforts here below to make this world a fit place in which to live, instead of the place that the churches in all these centuries have made it. I remember the first time I read that essay. It's entitled, Why I Am Not a Christian. I was new in seminary, and it forced me to remember, if not confront, some of the fears in my life. Fear of failure, fear of the unknown, fear of illness, fear of death. Fears of betrayal, fears of letting other people down. I find that in my own experience, and perhaps in your experience as well, we are often beset by fears. And perhaps they evolve as we mature, but I dare say that they never quite evaporate or go away. In William James's book, The Varieties of Religious Experience, he describes a colleague who had a childhood episode where he was traumatized by a sense of fear. It was invisible, and yet it came and seemed to brush up against him. Unwelcome, unseen, and yet there it was. And when I read that anecdote, I remembered an incident in my own life when I was perhaps 12 years old. I forget what time of year it was, but I was in the garage, and suddenly I felt as though there was a presence of pure evil. My response was panic. I began to recite prayers quickly, and I tried to physically remove myself from what felt so real, so present, and yet it followed me. I don't know how long it haunted me that day, but I was in the grips of terror and panic, and I cannot say what was there or what was not. Having been raised in a faith tradition, which I was accustomed to believe that there were many unseen forces in the world that could act for ill or for good. In fact, many peoples over the history of our species have often resorted to various charms and prayers to ward off evil spirits. And I found myself in the 20th century, a student of history, psychology, and science, such as a 12-year-old could understand them, gripped by an ineffable fear of something that may have been nothing. Some people talk about the dark night of the soul. Many of us, especially those who have come from a different faith tradition, have perhaps groped with a moment in our lives when we did not know our place. Like the ancients of old who looked up and scanned the horizons and saw the vastness of time and space and felt themselves very, very small. I remember I was in my 20s at that point, having gone through a very painful divorce, the loss of a grandmother, various other misfortunes. And I found myself no longer satisfied by the prayers of my youth. I thought, I drew, I processed, and I came to the conclusion, which was dreadful and yet liberating, that there was no unseen spirits, that there was no big brother in the sky, that this was what was real, this life was what was real, and that there were no other support systems outside of family and friends and the civilizations built up, but at root, I was alone. I thought back of some of the readings which had lifted me up at a younger, more tender age, one of which was the poem which you will recall, perhaps, of a man on a beach who looks back and sees two sets of footprints, and then after a stretch sees only one set of footprints. He thought he'd been walking with God. And he asked God, "I see at one point there is only one set of footprints. Where were you?" And the response from that tender elder brother said, "Actually, it was the times when you could not carry yourself, so I carried you forward." I propose to you that for many peoples of the world, that is a view of the world that works extremely well. That in times of terror, times of panic, times of loss, times of grief, times of abandonment, when we know that we cannot trust other people, perhaps we cannot even trust ourselves, to look towards this other entity, this deity, to sustain us, to support us, to succor us in those moments, so that we can again find our strength to resume walking forward. In this tradition, both among Unitarians and Universalists, there are many examples of how we have responded to fear. In many ways, it is a reaction against the dominant Calvinist theology that gripped this nation's psychology and its theology for so many centuries since its founding. You may recall that Jonathan Edwards wrote a searing poem called "We Are Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God, who holds us as though a loathsome spider," there's that spider again, "over a burning cauldron. And it is only by his grace and mercy that he does not let us go and be consumed by the fire." That particular brand of theology, very dark, laced with terror, was in fact part and parcel of the Puritan heritage, which infiltrated itself into various other denominations and gospel narratives as they were preached on the frontiers, even here in Springfield. It was very common for people to recoil in terror. In fact, whole groups, such as the Quakers and the Shakers, responded to the preaching and the messages by literally falling down and shaking. Fear and trembling. That was taken as a sign of deep piety, that our God is an angry God, a jealous God, one that seeks vengeance unto the seventh generation if need be, a God that will flood the entire earth to exterminate nearly the entire species if need be, a God of judgment, a man of war. In some places, of course, that is still the primary message. And people respond in fear, but also driven by a hope that they will be one of the fortunate few plucked from the fires through God's own favor, not by any merit of their own, and delivered to salvation. And so that was the crucible in which Unitarianism and Universalism began to be born and to differentiate itself from the other religious streams in this country. One of my favorite stories about William Ellery Channing, who was the unofficial founder of the Unitarian movement, was a recollection of himself as a child. He'd gone to church and heard the preacher deliver a sermon promising damnation, a day of doom to all. It scared him. It frightened him out of his mind. And it was reinforced by his father, who said, "Good sermon, sound doctrine." Mm-hmm. And then they left the church, and young William Ellery Channing remembered as they were going home, as he sat frightened by all the possibilities His father began to whistle. And it occurred to him as a child in that one moment, his father didn't believe a word of it. Another milestone happened with the early Universalists. It was John Murray who boldly proclaimed to his generation and to those which were to follow, "Give them not hell but hope." This was a direct contradiction of the Calvinist message. You will recall in the Calvinist methodology, we are all damned, we are all sinners, but only 166,000 souls will be plucked out of the abyss at the end of time and ushered into heaven. And there's nothing, absolutely nothing, that any one of us can do. Those who were chosen to be saved were chosen before the creation of the earth, the sun, and the stars. The Puritans believed you cannot know if you are one of the fortunate few. But sometimes God will give you a welcome sign, such as you get rich, your cattle are healthy, and your neighbors die. So God, in his subtle way, wink, wink, nudge, nudge, is showing you that you are one of the fortunate few. The Universalists said, "We have read in Scripture how just as in one man, Adam, all fell, so too another, through another, all shall be saved." And they interpreted that and many other kindred scriptures as proving the point that God is a God of love, not of vengeance and anger. That certainly the God of the new revelation promised a good and gracious God and an assured pathway to salvation, not just for those who believed, but for every human being, whoever lived, who is living now, or is yet to be born. Universal salvation, and you didn't have to do anything. So just as the Calvinists said, you're going to hell, and there's nothing you can do about it, the Universalists countered that with, actually, you're all going to heaven, and there's nothing you can do to prevent it. And so that truly became the good news. And it was on that basis that Universalist congregations, large and small, were formed, in particular here in the Midwest. Even in Springfield, there was a Universalist congregation at Fifth and Cook. There was one in Rochester, one in Loamy, one in Decatur, and so forth and so on. Little congregations, usually several families that banded together, formed and declared themselves followers of this new, incredibly optimistic faith. In time, the other larger denominations began to filter their message through a more optimistic lens. And instead of this vengeful father, they began to emphasize the role of Jesus as Savior and to offer much more promise of a happy ending for people. Now in 1933, the Unitarians took the next logical step. Basking in the glow of science and reason and centuries of study of humankind, of nature, of the stars, they issued what was called the Humanist Manifesto. In this manifesto, and I'll update the language, today's humans' larger understanding of the universe, our academic achievements and deeper appreciation of brotherhood have created a situation which requires a new statement of the means and purposes of religion, such a vital, fearless, and frank religion, capable of furnishing adequate social goals and personal satisfactions, may appear to many people as a complete break with the past. We will learn to face the crises of life in terms of our knowledge of their naturalness and probability. Reasonable and mature attitudes will be fostered by education and supported by custom. We assume that humanism will take the path of social and mental hygiene and discourage sentimental and unreal hopes and wishful thinking. And lastly, we assert that this new faith, this humanism, will not only affirm life rather than deny it, but will seek to elicit the possibilities of life, not to flee from them. And yet, with each generation, new people are born and are raised. Many of them are raised in a traditional religion that reinforces fear, if not suspicion. Others lose themselves, and some will go and find a new tradition. Earlier, you heard Frank Capecchi mention that Unitarian Universalists don't usually proselytize. And there's a good reason for that. It's because we too have our fears of appearing foolish in the eyes of our friends, neighbors, and coworkers who understand religion very differently, or would be very surprised to hear that their rational, sensible coworker is religious. How ironic. I have found that fear is inescapable. As I said earlier, I think it's an inherent essence of each individual. It is a building block for ourselves as well as our civilizations. We can name our fears. We could call it arachnophobia, or more telling to our present day, xenophobia, homophobia. And we could seek to have a prescription or an anecdote, but we realize through conversations and through our connectedness with others is that it's very difficult to overcome an irrational fear. You cannot reason the irrational out of other people, but perhaps, just perhaps, you can demonstrate through your life that you can welcome the stranger, you can welcome the refugee, you can welcome people who are LGBTQ, the other. We do not need to think alike, said Hosea Ballou, to love alike. And that is the mission, the primary mission of Unitarian Universalism, to teach that in spite of our fears, there is something much greater, a love and a kindred between our humanity. And we must cultivate that. We must nurture it in ourselves and in others so that we may face our fears, not expel them, not excommunicate them, not exorcise them, but incorporate them and acknowledge them and then move forward nonetheless. I believe that Robert Ingersoll, lawyer, debater, agnostic, one of the great lights from Peoria, spoke well when he said this. Someone once asked Confucius about another world, and his reply was, "How should we know anything about another world when we know so little of this one?" But he continued, "Immortality is a word that hope throughout all the ages has been whispering to love. All hope to meet again the loved and lost. The miracle of thought we cannot understand. The mystery of life and death we cannot comprehend. This chaos called the world has never been fully explained. And the golden bridge of life from gloom emerges and upon shadows rests. Beyond this we do not know. Fate is speechless. Destiny is dumb. And the secret of the future has never yet been told. We love, we wait, we hope. The more we love, the more we fear. Upon the tenderest heart, the deepest shadows fall. All pathways, whether filled with thorns or flowers, end here. Here, success and failure are the same. The rag of wretchedness and the purple robe of power, all difference and distinction lose in this democracy of death. And yet, character survives. Goodness lives. Love is immortal." And I think that that is very much a remarkable response to fear. To love the fear out of it, and in so doing, to create meaning. Rather than receiving meaning delivered by apostles or seers or preachers, to experience life itself fully, the good, the bad, the evil, and yet to hold faith that we can make meaning and contribute something to other people. I think that that is our highest calling as a people of faith. Not to deny fear, but to build a faith founded on love and perseverance. I suppose it has been the only thing that has held small groups of people together while beset by the worst terrors inflicted by nature or by humankind upon them. To believe that we will carry on and carry forward. And so we build communities. We create covenants with each other. We hold each other to promises. We know, of course, that promises can be broken and often are. We know that people being people will often let us down. But to hold faith in ourselves and our humanity, if not in this generation, in the generations yet to unfold, that we are more than the sum of our fears and phobias, that we can build something much stronger than a wall, that we can build connectedness with each other and connections and interconnectedness with all that is, to appreciate, to love, and to hold a sense of awe, deep, profound reverence for life and this universe and all that it embraces. It is a difficult journey. No one said it was going to be easy. And as Jim Morrison once said, no one gets out of here alive. And so I challenge us, all of us, to build something positive, to continue to hope, to trust in love, love in its different manifestations, personal, but also love in action, which is called justice, and to continue to build, brick by brick, a new sense, a new temple, enshrined in this hope and in this love. Blessed be, amen, so mote it be. Theodore Parker wrote this, "Be ours a religion which, like sunshine, goes everywhere, its temple, all space, its shrine, the good heart, its creed, all truth, its ritual, works of love, and its profession of faith, divine living." Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.